now we want to kind of, we've been talking about 2D graphics, and early on in our graphics, this is how everyone did computer graphics. You basically had a pin and plotter method, and your arm would go across the screen, and you would find your X value, your Y value, and you'd make a mark. Anyone ever program old snow? Of course, basically doesn't exist anymore, but I remember when I was a kid, like in fourth grade, my first computer, the first graphical thing I was able to do was on BASIC, and you basically set the plot as individual point, and then if you used functions or subroutines, you could make a line, we could make up a box, and it was really cool. But this is the kind of method that they use to create the graphics, is how you're doing it with the kind of the 2D graphics mode. With the exception that they didn't have nice circles and arcs, et cetera. And this is kind of would go to the point of immediate mode. The earliest form of computer graphics where we would just write lines and points to the screen, and there's no real stored data for the geometry. That means every frame or every update you have to re-render the whole scene. Now you actually do end up having to re-render the whole scene regardless, but this is actually kind of difficult to maintain because you can't say, okay, where the object was before, now I want to move it this way. You just have to either have to have your own data structures for it, or you have to know how to render the scene over and over again. So this is actually a little bit trickier to keep track of where things are. You're basically just going to spit out pixels and lines to the screen. In the retain mode graphics, you have to essentially set up your own vertices, and you're going to store the geometry of the shape. And you're going to store this in arrays or some sort of data structure. And what's nice is some of how this will eventually work, you'll realize a little bit later, but what's going to happen is we're going to have our shape and our vertices, and we're going to send that all at once to the graphics card, and we don't have to do this every frame. We'll have to say which thing we're going to modify, but we don't have to send our pixel or vertice values to the graphics card every frame. So this makes the step a lot easier, especially for 3D. Immediate mode is fine for 2D. I mean, you're not going to crush a system bus sending in 400 by 600 pixel values, if that. So that's not a real issue. But when you have 3D graphics and you have many, many, many more vertices, then it becomes an issue that we have to deal with. So what we're going to see here very quickly is we're going to set up our data, or set up a state, not the slate, just the data, and then we're going to send it to the GPU, and we want to do that step once, mainly the vertice data, and then we're going to basically tell the GPU, okay, we're going to use this thing we sent you, or we're going to use this thing, and then we're going to render it. And the thing, so to speak, of what the GPU is referring to is going to be a buffer. We're going to create a buffer for each one of our shapes, and then we're going to send our data in, and then we can tell the GPU, okay, switch to this buffer, and then render it. And then we can, after we have the buffers placed, we can worry about moving our objects around, et cetera. So in WebGL, we can do 2D or 3D. This is one of the major contributions, or one of the major points of OpenGL and the early 3D engines. It's like we said, we need a system that can do that, where 2D is a special case of 3D. Because if you think about it, like say no graphics engines existed, and you've all been hired to make the very first graphics engine. Yeah. It kind of makes sense, because if I just make the Z value 0 on everything, I now have 2D. So it makes sense that we should, you know, B be able to do this. This is actually not as easy as it sounds, which we'll talk about, but we should be able to do this. And then there's actually a fourth value for the 3D point, and there's actually a third value for the 2D point for transform matrices, but we're not gonna worry about that right now. So we have 2D or 3D points are usable in WebGL and OpenGL, and 2D is going to be a special case of 3D. As remember, I just mentioned before on this, that there used to be a special case where you'd have to toggle the mode. You said, okay, if you want to make a 2D thing, you set this switch, and then you have your 2D API, which is basically your pen and plotter method. And then if you want to do 3D, you have to set this switch, and now you can use 3D, you have the 3D API, and it was kind of one or the other. Well, like I said, I think WebGL allows us the option to use 2D just because it's simpler than WebGL, HTML5 allows us to use 2D just because it's simpler than WebGL, but WebGL can actually do 2D on its own as well. So if you were going to create, yes?
It's the depth for now. We don't have to worry about matrices, but I've heard from people that there are some used later in the course, and I haven't taken linear algebra, so I don't, like, how much.
Sorry, I should say for now, keyword here is now.
Yeah, but later will we have to?
We will be using matrices later.
Will we have to research how to do that?
I will hopefully be able to give you enough background to get you through it. I mean, the nice thing is the GPU is going to do the math for you.
Okay, yeah. So, I don't.
But you do need to understand the mechanics of the transform matrix, which I'm going to go over, and hopefully that will be enough. But we'll cross that bridge. All right. So if you were to create your own graphical API, you would need the following function. You would need the following general functions. You would need the primitive functions, which essentially means defining low-level objects or atomic entities. So what's the very basic thing that your graphics engine can print? Obviously, it should be a point, and then probably a line, and then beyond that depends on what you're trying to make. You need to have a set of attribute functions, which are going to set values and properties, such as color. You need to have a viewing function, which will determine how to view the world and how objects are going to move in the world. Viewing is going to be just for how you view the world. Now, an interesting point here, WebGL does not use functions for this. Instead, they're going to use essentially just matrix math. So they actually bypass this step by using pure matrices, and they don't worry about actually having functions or how you view the world. This is a kind of difficult component when you set up like camera movement and you want to change your camera. This can become an issue, but just because it's not as simple as simply calling a function and setting what your values are. You have to either make that function or you have to set the transform matrices in your shader manually. And then you have transform functions. This will allow translation, rotation, and scaling. This is referred to as the rigid body movement. So if you take any rigid body, I can hypothetically make it bigger or smaller, I can rotate it, and I can move it. And that's basically how we are going to move objects in this class. So we with transformation functions. Again, this is not done with a function in WebGL as much as it's done with a matrix. We will kind of make our own move functions, but in the back end of it, or how it's actually working, will be a matrix. And in the other categories you might have in a graphics engine is an input function. Almost all applications you can think of that have graphics are going to need some sort of input. And that was one of the points that Angel makes in his book. I believe that, ironically enough, WebGL does not do this. And they do not do this because they want to be platform independent. And this, when OpenGL was designed, it was back in the early days of computing, and they didn't even know what hardware it was going to run on. And so they actually have almost, they decided that the native language C would be responsible for input functions, and there would be almost no input or inputability on the WebGL itself. So this one's kind of a wild card, whether or not you actually need it. And then you've got control functions that allow you to interact with the window system or handle errors if an error occurs. And then if you want to query, you need query functions if you want to test a particular implementation that you've implemented. Whether or not something, there's a block there, whether or not what color it is. You need some way to access information in the scene that you've created to, if you want to query functions from. So this is the general functionality of a graphical API, or a graphics API. Now, the coordinate system in OpenGL and WebGL is going to be on X, Y, Z, regardless is if you use 2D or 3D. The way WebGL is going to do 2D is it's going to make the camera orthographic, but it will still respect the Z-axis, so you can use that to set depth. all coordinates are going to range from -1 to 1. And this is going to be one of those things that we can't get around. And we'll explain, my first thing is this thing's really limiting, but it actually kind of makes sense because this ends up being one normalized vector to the right, one normalized vector to the left, one normalized vector up, one normalized vector down. So, and forward and back. So it actually kind of makes sense to do it this way. But so all our coordinates by default are going to go from -1, then you have the center of the screen, and then you have 1. Or you have 1, 0, and -1 going down the y-axis, and then you have the z-axis is pointing out of the screen at you. I believe positive is going that way. I always get that one reversed on WebGL, but I believe it's going that way. and then you are going to also have several different coordinates. Another coordinates you're going to have is the screen coordinates. And the overarching problem that we have to solve in graphics is this idea that I have a 3D model, I have a 3D context, and then it's got to somehow end up in the 2D screen coordinates, X and Y values on the screen. I have to end up with a picture from a 3D model. And so this, you have the screen coordinates, which will actually be kind of like the last stage of the rendering pipeline. And then you have window coordinates. Sometimes they'll have window coordinates depending on the implementation or the platform. Now, very, very important. So know this one. These are the WebGL primitives. Now, when they designed WebGL, there's two different, kind of schools of thought for 3D graphics. Yeah. One was, if I create enough primitive 3D objects, from these 3D objects, I can construct anything I want. And so this is kind of analogous to how the 3D rendering software like Maya or Blender work. You've got the torus, you've got the cube, you've got the cone, you have all these primitive 3D objects, and from that you can construct and extrude and whatever you need to do to create whatever shape you want. On the programming side of it, and the one that actually won out as far as the programming side of graphics is, well, we can model everything in a triangle. We make the triangle small enough, we can make a sphere that's a triangle. If we make the triangle small enough, we can make a human arm, and it's being composed of triangles. But now we have to have one shape. And so you'll see that this philosophy actually won out, because even on the like say the Blenders and Mayas, if you zoom into your vertices, you're going to see everything's a triangle. There is no other. So you have the option for points, lines, line strips, line loops, and I'll go through these in a little more detail. The triangle strip, just normal triangles, and a triangle fan. These are your options to render with. You have no other options. So this is, and again, the point is, from these triangles, I can actually create anything I want. So GL points, if I have a list of points, each point gets a point. And I think you have to set, I forgot how to do this, so you have to set the point size in order to see it, otherwise you won't see the point render. If you have GL lines, every 2 points will be a single line. So if I have 4 points, I get 2 lines. They will not necessarily be connected. So you have to remember how the different points are going to work. So if I have 4 points, the first 2 will go to this line, the second 2 points will go to this line. If I have a GL line strip and I have 4 points, then what happens is each point gets added on to the last point that was rendered, which is probably what you, more often than not, people think of this when they think of rendering a line. Because if you do lines, you have to say, okay, 1 point, 2 point, and repeat, 3 point, 4 point, if you want to connect them. So more often than not, people are thinking of GL line strip when they think of drawing a line. And that's going to say every new point you have will be added on to this line. It'll be just from where the pencil's currently at, now we're going to draw a line to that new point. And GL line loop means when I'm done rendering, the last line rendered, then we'll render back to the beginning. Does that make sense? Now, GL triangle strip is going to take the first 3 points, make a triangle, and then the last 2 points in that triangle with the next point added will make the next triangle. So if I have point 1, point 2, and point 3, actually say point 1, point 2, point 3, these are the last 2 points I've added. So I have 3 points, I get 1 triangle, I add a 4th point here, and now the last 2 points of the first triangle and that 4th point make a 3rd triangle, or 2nd triangle. This is really nice because now, after I made the first triangle, I can make an entirely new triangle with just 1 point that can really save data. So the number of points I actually need for this triangle strip is at 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. I need 8 vertices to render this whole thing instead of having one vertice for each corner of the triangle. Does that make sense? GL triangles, similar to GL lines, is going to take the first 3 vertices and make a triangle out of it. It will not, if you have more than 3 vertices, it will not combine the triangles. It will just have a 2nd triangle or a 3rd triangle. So it basically take the number of points you have in your vertice array, divide it by 3, and that's how many triangles you're going to have if you use GL triangles. And the last one they made was GL triangle fan. And this one, what happens is I have the first triangle, which takes 3 points. And then the last point and the first point become kind of my, everything's going to come from this first point. So the last point, so I add a 4th point over here. The last point of my triangle and the first point become the other side of the triangle, which gives me a new triangle. And then I add another point. Well, the last point was the first point I added, and the original gives me another triangle, etc. And I can make this triangle fan around the center. And again, this is nice because I can create a new triangle by simply adding 1 vertice. So
very quickly they realized vertices take up memory, and the more vertices you have, the more the slower things run. So if you can reduce the number of vertices, the better off this will work.
So this is conceptually, well this is, not just conceptually, this is how WebGL is going to render.
And we're going to talk a little bit, I think in chapter 4, we talk about why this is. But essentially, we want to use triangles. You want to try to avoid long, skinny triangles. And you don't have to be overly cautious on this. A lot of people are like, oh my gosh, if the triangle is less than 45 degree angle, it's not going to work out. What they're talking about is, bless you, is if you have like a 1 or 2 radian degree angle here, it's going to be really hard for the renderer to differentiate between a triangle and a line. So you want to keep it, 5 degrees or more, I would say, as your minimum angle. But you want to try to avoid long, skinny triangles. They do not render well. Equilateral triangles are the best because you maximize the minimum angle. And that's the most ideal. So convex polygons are another important component to graphics. And this is one reason the triangle was chosen. I have a polygon, forget triangles for a moment, I just have a polygon. If I can go to A and I can draw a line to any other point in the polygon, then it's a convex polygon. And that's very good. I want that in graphics, because otherwise my rasterizer and my shaders are going to just hate me for it. If you think about this, what would be a bad example is, say I had a shape, again, forget triangles for a moment, say just one shape of a horseshoe. You know what a horseshoe is, right? Hopefully. So if I take a point on my horseshoe shape on this side and try to draw a line to the horseshoe shape on this side, now there's a gap. I can't go from one point to the other point. So that is not a convex shape. Now the workaround is I have a bunch of different shapes to compose my horseshoe shape, and each of the subshapes are convex. That's okay. But I can't have one shape that is not convex, or I don't want to have a shape that's not convex. And that is, again, one of the reasons triangles want out versus this idea of having primitive 3D objects, is because, what happens if someone makes a 3D object where the vertex is not convex, then the whole graphics engine breaks. If you think about convex polygons, if I have a triangle now, let's go back to the triangle, it's impossible for me to select a point on a line and draw to another point on another line and not have it reach. I mean, in order to truly do that, you would have to bend that triangle on an end dimension, which that doesn't make any sense for our context. So it's actually impossible for us to have a non-convex triangle. If I go here, I can go here, I can go here. Even if I have a really small angle, I can still, hypothetically, the shape will be convex. So now, if I break all my complex objects up into little tiny triangles, let's say a human arm. I want to model a human arm for a video game. Well, I guarantee that the human arm by no means is convex, right? I mean, I have a point here, and I have my shoulder. There is no way that's convex. But if I break this up into triangles, then I guarantee that all the shapes here will be convex, but yet I am relaying an image or a displaying something that is much more complex. And so once again, this is probably a big reason why the triangle won out with being the only true polygon created, because it guarantees that your shape will be convex. Now, that's not to say you can't mess things up. I mean, you can make a mesh that then goes through itself, but each individual triangle of that mesh will be in fact convex. So it's not to say it's bulletproof, but it alleviates this issue of having a rasterizer trying to figure out what to do with this empty space. Questions with that? Alright. So we're gonna get into color a little bit. Actually we're gonna use color a lot. Color is you have two different types. You have the additive color model, which is RGB, and the more values you add, the closer it gets to white. And this is really nice because it models light very, very accurately. You can use this to model white light very nicely. Hypothetically you could model other light too, but you just have to, the light source you use would have to be restricted to one channel or a subset of these values. Subtractive color is cyan, magenta, yellow. This is what's used for printing. And the more colors you add together, you get closer to black. So if you're an artist, you've probably seen this model before. Otherwise, it's not used a lot, except in the realm of printing, because it works nicely for printing. I have a white piece of paper, and then I add stuff to it. And the more I add, the darker the color gets. So those are the two different models. This semester, we'll be focusing on the additive color model. Any questions with that? We all know the additive color model from HTML, right? Okay, so that, there we go. That same idea of HTML applies here, except that we're gonna have to, we have to remember that our color model is going to be in terms of our floating points from 0 to 1. That's the only catch. Now, there are two different perspectives allowed, basically, and there's really no, I guess there's actually a third. You can do isometric as well, but normally you're going to have the normal perspective, which is what we see in reality. And the defining point is parallel points cross at the horizon. Now, I'm not going to go into this too much right now, but I want you to stop thinking about what you see and start thinking about as if what you see is a painting. Because it sometimes won't make sense if you don't. We, as human beings, growing up, we've learned how to see, per se. We've learned how different properties of the real world work. And so if we're standing on a freeway, first of all, we've done something wrong. But assuming, for hypothetically, we're standing on a safe freeway, and we can see the lines of the lane going off into the distance, and they reach a certain point at the far distance. But we know, humanly, that those points don't actually touch. It's just they're going really far away, so it looks like they're touching. But we know that those points are parallel. We have to think kind of in that, almost like a child. You're like, oh, I can reach the moon. The moon's right there. You know, we have to kind of think in that level when we start talking about graphics, because now we have to remember that at a certain point, we have to render the image as those lines touching, and we have to understand what's happening. So horizontal lines or parallel lines are going to cross at the horizon, and everything's going to get smaller as it gets farther away. Orthographic projection, there's two ways of looking at it. If you imagine a camera with an infinitely long telephoto lens, which doesn't actually help me very much, or essentially making it that the Z value has no effect on the depth or the size of the object, or the X and the Y. So if I have orthographic, I have a square here. This square could be 2 inches from your face, or it could be billions of miles away, it's still going to look the same.
You have no idea how far that square is from you if you're in orthographic perspective.
And this is how WebGL is going to handle 2D. This is most commonly used outside of 2D games, I would say, in drafting. One thing I mentioned here, the camera representation, I apologize, I want to mark her with me, is going to be a thrust up, which is kind of like a 3D trapezoid. All right. So this is a frustum, which will be a 3D version of a trapezoid. You can kind of imagine that. And the smaller, the top of the 3D trapezoid is what's closer to the camera. And the far plane is going to be the larger base. And that's going to represent how the camera is viewing reality. And you've probably seen this if you use Maya or Blender or Unity. If you click on the camera, there'll be this frustum sticking out. You'll be like, oh, that's what the camera sees. Orthographic is going to just be a box. And the front plane, the near plane and the far plane are going to be the same size. It's just a box or a rectangle sticking out. And that's a very good way to represent the two different types of perspectives. So the aspect ratio is going to be the width and the height of the rectangle. It's going to be the ratio of the width and the height of the rectangle. And this is important because the aspect ratio is not going to necessarily be the resolution. Did I miss this line? I did not. Okay. So a lot of people think, oh, aspect ratio, that means resolution. No, there's multiple resolutions that have the same aspect ratio. You have to remember that. The camera and the viewport will also have an aspect ratio. If you differ the two, you can see distortion on the screen.